Down by 15 in the national championship, Kansas rallied the second half to beat North Carolina. Down by 13 at halftime to the 2021 national champs, Baylor, the Kansas Jayhawks rally yet again. The national championship team from 2022 in the house at Allen Fieldhouse, and they put on a clinic. They were down by 17 at one point, Kansas won, and they went on a 64-31 run. They just absolutely steamrolled Baylor in the second half, shooting an eye-popping 63% from the floor. They were 1 of 11 from deep in the first half, 5 of 10 in the second half. As really Baylor, their guards of Keontae George, LJ Cryer, and Adam Flagler, they just sort of ran out of gas. They scored 42 of the 45 first half points for Baylor. And look, you know, that's what Scott Drew's going to do. Not going to play a deep bench. That's fine. Either as Bill Self. Sometimes you run out of gas. Sometimes you run into a buzzsaw like Kansas in the second half. 87-71, the final from Lawrence. Get some instant analysis. Welcome in CBS Sports HQ college basketball analyst Matt Norlander. And Matt, that was a heck of a game, a tale really of two halves. What's your reaction to how this game played out?
My reaction is that I don't want us to ever forget that Kansas outscored Baylor 64-31. 64-31. This is a Baylor team that had been playing better than any other team in the country over the previous 5 weeks and was 10-1 in his previous 11 games. The only loss in a very close game on the road against Texas, which is now tied atop the Big 12 standings with Kansas. Baylor obviously drops one game behind here. I will deal with Baylor quickly first. And that is just to say, in the first half, the guards were absolutely on fire. You saw why Baylor has a claim to having the best three-headed monster in the backcourt in the country with Flagler, Cryer, and Keontae George. And then most of it was Kansas's doing, but it all just seemed to evaporate. There is something about that building in Kansas. There is a voodoo there. Obviously, the players and Bill Self and that staff get the credit, but I'm talking about over the ages. I see so many ways of Kansas winning games. Big comebacks, close games, they finish it on top. It is statistically the hardest building to win in major American sports, at least on the men's side. In men's college basketball, Kansas has been incredible there, and you can see how that defense shut Baylor down. Extremely impressive. For Baylor, I'm not too down on them moving forward from this, Hakeem. It is stunning that Kansas did it this way, but the reality is this. Baylor is not an A-level, and I would argue not even like a B-plus level defensive team, maybe not even a B defensive team. It ranks in the 70s in points per possession allowed, and it has the best offense in the country, but Kansas matched that step for step and beyond in the second half. And so Baylor will recover itself. I think it'll be fine, but an appropriate win for the Jayhawks to win with that much authority. I mean, Ochai Agbaji, you saw it there. Like, he was laughing on the sideline because no one could believe the state of that game midway through the second half after, again, 64-31. 64-31. That's outrageous.
It is outrageous. Down 17, 64-31. We'll repeat it because it's worth repeating. Also, in terms of repeating, Kansas looking to repeat and run it back. What did you learn? What did you take away from this win? Because this is a big win over a top 10 team, because we haven't had a whole lot of separation right among the number ones. And of course, Kansas was released as a number one here on the selection committee on this day. But in terms of what this win said about Kansas, do you feel like this was a statement win for Bill Self and the Jayhawks?
Okay, so I think within the world of us who love college basketball, and me and Gary Parrish talk about it at least three times a week on the Eye on College Basketball podcast, we have been discussing Kansas's viability to repeat as a national champion. That has been on our radar since December. But for the national audience, for folks that have just been starting to pick up college hoops a bit more in the past week, or even the past month, you've been following since college football season ended, this is the performance. You know, big time game. There weren't a lot of other good games happening when Kansas did this, where you see, okay, a lot of the roster from last season wasn't playing. It was sitting two rows deep. Those guys aren't in the uniform anymore. But you saw here in how it won, And I think DeJuan Harris, he asked me what else I learned, Hakeem. I think DeJuan Harris's play as a pass-first, pass-second point guard becomes more and more important to this team. They went through a stretch Kansas did in this game in terms of game time. They went like 28 minutes between turnovers. Huge, huge stuff here. A couple of really, really good teams there. Kansas, oh, by the way, its viability to repeat as national champion will be increased if it can remain on the one line. And we are almost at the point where that might not be reversible. Obviously, Kansas could still go down to the two. But this was the 13th quad one win for Kansas this season. No other team in the country has more than 9. 13 versus 9. So really, if Kansas can get one more, it almost might be impossible to knock them off the one line, because there's probably not going to be no one else in the country that can compete with the amount of high-level wins. The better the seed, the better your road is, in theory, to get to the Final Four. Kansas is on the short list, and by short list, Hakeem, I mean among the 3 to 5 most realistic national champion contenders. That was not the case in the preseason. Kansas was thought to be good. Baylor was the Big 12 favorite. We are curling to the last week of February, and it is Longhorns and Jayhawks atop the league. And oh, by the way, Kansas in 2 weeks will go and play in Austin. The number one seed in the Big 12 tournament could be on the line.
Yeah, Texas surviving overtime against unranked Oklahoma today. As you know, the NCAA selection committee releasing their top 16 seeds. Kansas a 1 seed, Baylor a 2 seed. In terms of the big picture in the top 16, and we've got 5 Big 12 teams among the top 12. What did you learn? What did you take away with less than 3 weeks to go until Selection Sunday?
I didn't have any huge gripes with the top 16. I thought Indiana was seeded a bit too high, and remember that top 16 came out prior to Indiana getting a nice home win in a competitive game over a really good Illinois team that was shorthanded. I thought Tennessee was too high overall in the seeding. It was number 9. Now, again, I'm not going to take Tennessee's loss that it took against Kentucky. I'm not going to hold it against them because the committee didn't evaluate Tennessee before they played that game there. But you can see region by region. You'll notice one ACC team, Hakeem, Virginia, yep, there on the 3 line. I think the strongest of these regions, personally, after what I saw Kansas do, I might reconsider, but to me it feels like the South is the strongest. Alabama, Baylor, Virginia, Indiana. You had teams just on the outside looking in. Creighton, St. Mary. The teams you're not seeing on your screen right now, Creighton, UConn, St. Mary's, Miami. We've got a really good competitive race here going for the 4 line, for the 5 line. Also important from my HQ interview with the chair, Chris Reynolds, he said no other team was in contention for the 1 line. It was those 4 that had separated from the pack. So we've got time and a quick history lesson for you. Since they started doing this in 2017, every year, like clockwork, 3 of the 4 teams remain on the 1 line and 1 drops down to the 2. 1 will hop up. Which one will that be? It kind of remains to be seen, but I think that Purdue and Houston are the most vulnerable of the 4. After Kansas winning, I can't say it's all that vulnerable. And then more than 80% of the teams that make the top 16 February reveal, they stay on the 1, 2, 3, or 4 line. So some will drop down, some will drop up. But a lot of the teams that you saw here with 3 weeks to go are likely to get top 4 seeds. And as you well know, Hakeem, why is that so important? Not just because of good seeding, but for the most part, if you are a 1, 2, 3, or 4 seed, you will get geographic preference for the first weekend and then usually into the second weekend. But as Reynolds said on HQ, because the Big 12 has so many good teams, by rule, bracketing principles, the top 4 Big 12 teams, they got to go to all 4 regions of the country. So that might wind up sending one of those teams to a spot where it wouldn't love to go. But the consolation prize is you'll be seated quite nicely.
Can we bring up that full screen real quick before I let Matt go here? Good luck getting out of the West. Kansas, Arizona, Kansas State, and Gonzaga. You got the 2 Kansas schools there, Bill Self, Jerome Tang. And then you got Tommy Lloyd against his former school, Gonzaga. Like, good luck getting out of the West, Matt. I mean, because this could be an absolute wild region when you consider that Kansas arguably had the easiest path to the Final Four last year.
Yeah, and I'll be quick on this, Hakeem. I like you brought that up because, one, I didn't even pick up on the Lloyd-Gonzaga thing. Gonzaga is a national championship contender anyway, and Kansas, with how it played in Kansas and Arizona and Gonzaga, 3 of the 8 to 9 strongest national championship contenders to me overall. I fade K-State just a little bit, but man, seeing those teams on a screen like that, I'm getting plenty, plenty amped here. 3 weeks until we get the big one for real. Can't wait.
I love it. The big one, Kansas beats Baylor, a matchup of the last two national champions, as the Jayhawks improved to 13-1 at home this season. Down 17, they outscored the Bears 64-31. Matt, appreciate the insight and the breakdown here on CBS Sports HQ. And for much more awesome content, join Matt and Gary Parrish on the Ion College Basketball Podcast. They'll have one out ready for a what a weekend this has been. We got two one seeds playing on Sunday as well, with Purdue looking to bounce back. Houston, the presumptive number one if they take care of business against Memphis. Matt and Gary will have that all wrapped up for you on the Ion College Basketball Podcast. Download and follow today.
Do you want a sports network that delivers everything that matters about the game? The highlights, the picks, the instant analysis. No yelling, no fake debates, no politics. Hit the subscribe button and never miss a moment.